everyone. Thank you for joining us for the ProMedica Defiance Women's Health Talk. Just before we get started, we will have Dr. Gibbs do his presentation, and then at the end we will have time for a question and answer where you can go ahead and answer. We will answer questions in the chat. And so I would like to introduce Dr. Gibbs. Dr. Gibbs, go ahead and tell us a little bit about your background.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Courtney, for letting me do this. I'm very passionate about this. There's so much not known and so much misinformation about menopause. I've been an obstetrician gynecologist for 35 years, and back in 2002, went to my first menopause meeting and have been going since, and became certified in menopause, became a menopause practitioner, it's called, through the North American Menopause Society. And it is the only organization out there that actually has anything organized to teach people the ins and outs of menopause and present, I think, scientifically sound information. So I've been doing a lot of this in my practice, and now I've come out to Defiance for 1 week a month and enjoy very much that area and helping the people with all the OBGYN needs, including menopause. So I think I'll just go ahead and get started. And in our precious moments together, I want to really focus on just getting a basic understanding of, you know, what's menopause, and you know, where's it come from, and why do we need to talk about it? It occurs because of the loss of estrogen, and that happens because the ovaries in the body stop functioning, and that's where most estrogen is made. And this can occur naturally, or it can be induced by surgery or by medication. And the reason this is such an important subject is because all women who survive through midlife will experience menopause. Now, let me stop there. Not all women will have babies. Not all women will have cancer. But we spend so much time about these. They're important, you know, certainly important things to talk about, to study, and to teach. But menopause is the only thing that all women, that's 100% of women, will experience if they go through the menopause. So it's a very important discussion. And the thing that, you know, I've had so many people over the years come in and say, you know, where's the handbook to this thing? You know, why didn't nobody warned me about this? And so we need to have that discussion more and more to let people know not only what's happening, but things that can be done, because everybody's menopause is different, because there's a wide variety of symptoms, as you'll see, but everybody's menopause is different, and that is dependent on so many things. And so the thing we have to do is individualize what we do for people. And the very interesting reality is that women will spend up to 40% of their lives in the menopause. Now, you know, humans are called mammals, and if you look at the world of mammals, other mammals go through menopause too, but none live beyond, very far beyond, when they become menopausal, like monkeys. Very few monkeys live to be menopausal, or if they do, they don't live very long after. Humans live 40% of their lives in the menopause. And so this is so important to understand what this is all about. So the average age of menopause is 51. And interestingly enough, that crosses all boundaries of space. I mean, in all cultures, it's around 51. And it's been 51 since people started talking about this. So that's an interesting thing to note. And the other really important thing to know about menopause is that it's a transition. You know, going like when you went through puberty, it didn't happen overnight, didn't happen in one day. It was a process. And it can take years. It can take really 10 years. And a lot of times the process starts in one's early 40s. And the range we see people going through menopause is from 45 to approximately 55. The oldest person that is on record for going the latest, the oldest person that went through menopause that's been recorded is 59. So most people by 55 are menopausal. So there's this transition. And like I said earlier, it can be induced or natural. And if you go through menopause naturally, that's around the age of 51. But induced menopause can happen anytime. If you have a hysterectomy at 40, and if they take the ovaries along with the uterus, that's going to induce menopause. Now, something I think is very important for you to understand is when I use the word hysterectomy, literally what that means is to remove the uterus, period, only the uterus. And when we talk about a hysterectomy, if we remove the ovaries, then we're talking about a hysterectomy and an oophorectomy. That's another term. But it means that we take the uterus and the ovaries. To take the uterus out doesn't necessarily mean you're going to go through menopause at all. If you leave the ovaries, you won't. And that's the idea where many, many people are going today with this, is that they really try and leave ovaries. There's other treatments, other things that can make a woman go through menopause earlier, and that would be radiation and chemotherapy. But and there are some women, about 3% of women will actually naturally or spontaneously, without any treatment or any surgery, actually go through menopause at a much younger age. But that's a much smaller group. That's possible, but that doesn't happen as often. So these are some of the things that happen at menopause. You lose your hormones, whether naturally or induced. And it's in if you have a surgery, the onset of menopause, the symptoms of menopause are much quicker. They're in a matter of weeks, as opposed to if you go through menopause spontaneously and you have 10 years to kind of warm up to it. It's a much different experience. And that's why, especially somebody getting their ovaries out at surgery, you really want to have that conversation, because those symptoms are going to hit you like a brick wall if you don't. So let's talk about the symptoms. And there's a wide variety of symptoms. And what you want to understand about this is today there's over 60 million women above the age of 50 in America. So there's a lot of women going through or have gone through menopause. This is not an uncommon event at all. And those doctors and nurses and practitioners taking care of women, it's not if you see these people that have gone through this, it's when you see them. There's a lot of people you're going to see in this group. And the most bitterly complained about symptom is the hot flashes, or some people call them flushes. Doctors will call them vasomotor symptoms, whatever you want to call it, fine by me. But they're hot flashes, and they can be minor, you know, a little bit of sweating, or they can be really intense. And what happens is the body really gets the sense that your temperature is going up. So it reacts to lower temperature. And what that does is your all the blood vessels on the skin open up and you get this flushing. And that's where that feeling comes from. And a lot of people, after they get the flushing, will actually shiver. And so it can be a very, very intense sensation. And if you have 8 or more a day, that's considered severe hot flashes. And again, they can be severe or more minor. And as it turns out, it's interesting that when you look at all the women going through this, approximately 50% will not have real severe symptoms. And I've had so many people come in and say, boy, what's everybody complaining about? This is not a big deal. And then you have people coming in and say, oh my God, you got to do something. I'm going to die. And so there's this wide variation. About 50% of people really would appreciate treatment. And as it turns out, all the studies show us that people don't want to come in. And this is what I tell doctors. They don't want to come in and tell you, doctor, I'm having all these symptoms. I feel terrible. Please do something. Patients going in to see doctors want doctors to say, are you having any symptoms? What can I do for you? And so I'm telling you that. So if you have these symptoms and you like help, do not hesitate. And if the doctor doesn't know much about it, then see if you can, you know, they can send you to somebody who does. And I want to tell you that a lot of people, and this is not throwing anybody under the bus or calling anybody stupid, but this is just not taught. And yesterday I gave a lecture to medical students, which will be their only lecture on menopause during their medical school experience. That's 4 years of education, one lecture. And you know, you just can't believe it. And many OB residents that I also lecture to, it's the same. If you're in a program where there's nobody really studying menopause, you just don't get it. When I went through the residency, we got one lecture when I was a resident, 4 years. And so you're not really prepared coming out on what to tell people. But as soon as you hit the door, everybody coming out into private practice always says two things. You know, you say, oh, how is your first couple months in private practice? They say two things. Well, nobody ever got me ready for the office and what that was like. And nobody got me ready to help people going through menopause. For years, people have told me that. So it's one of those things that it's just not taught as much. I mean, that's our fault. That's not your fault. But it's an honest thing to ask if you're having a lot of symptoms to try and get to somebody who's been trained. So hot flashes is the main thing that people really, really don't like. And there's so many ways that we'll be talking about in a few minutes to help people with that. Sleep disturbances are another big, big issue. And a lot of times a sleep disturbance happens because of the hot flashes. However, I want you to realize that sleep disturbances at this age of menopause can be due to a lot of other things. Some people have sleep apnea, and there's a number of medical conditions that can cause people to have poor sleep. And sleep at this age is an incredibly important, the mind, the brain, your thinking, to stamina. There's a lot of health issues. We see a lot of people with poor sleep that have high blood pressure. There's so many things that are tied to sleep now. And if you're having really a lot of trouble with sleep, you really want to pursue this. It doesn't seem like a big deal, but I can't overstate how important sleep is to an individual, especially at midlife. And menopause can be a huge factor in that. And there's, of course, again, ways of treating that. And that goes right into the next step here, where memory and concentration issues. I had a leader of a big corporation come to me one time, and she was walking in and all jolly and everything. And she, you know, we shut the door and she sat down, she looked at me, she goes, you got to help me. I can't think my way out of a paper bag. I mean, I'm a CEO of a company. You got to do something for me. And this is not an uncommon thing where people have, you know, memory issues, like how did that go? And or concentration, they can't really get their mind wrapped around things. And that's a very common issue. And that is related to a lot of things, but menopause can be a big factor in that. And that leads into really the second biggest complaint that people have, and that is mood disorders. And people can get, you know, really grumpy, and people come in and just say, you know, I'm just not me. You know, who am I? You know, I always look in the mirror in the morning and say, you know, where are you and what'd you do with me? You know, and it's very upsetting and very depressing to people that their mood switches. And this is an interesting thing because I get a lot of, you know, husbands that say, you know, she's a BIA, you know, and a little bit of a bitchy. So, but I always try and help husbands and say, well, I want you to do something for me to try and understand what your wife's going through. And I want you to go out and buy, it's a vitamin, it's called niacin. And I want you to get the niacin that's not the non-flashing, flushing niacin. I want you to just get regular niacin. And niacin's one of those, it's a vitamin, but it's one of those vitamins that if you take, it will cause a hot flash. And I always try, I did this. And, you know, you get in and you take some of these, and all of a sudden these hot flashes hit you, and you really appreciate what your partner's going through. Like, it's, oh my God. So, I mean, if you ever have your husband kind of, you know, what's that all about? That's not a big deal. Say, here's some niacin, take a few, and then let's talk about it. So, you know, the way you feel, you don't feel yourself, and mood, you know, mood is really big into that. So there's, again, a lot of treatments, and mood disorders can be due to a lot of different things. One of the things that we know, where a lot of people who have bad mood issues, one of the predictors of somebody who will have a lot of mood problems is if, as a younger person, you had bad PMS when you had your periods, or after a baby, if you had a baby and had a lot of problems with sadness or depression after the baby, those are hints. Those are little red flags that when you become menopausal, you may need to talk to somebody about mood and depression. So that's really, mood is number two. That's the big one. Now, vaginal dryness is another thing. And usually vaginal dryness is a later symptom that people get. You know, the hot flashes come first, the sleep, the mood, and then later you get the vaginal dryness. And so, but this can be very uncomfortable. I mean, some people really have problems sitting, and they're constantly aware of their itchy and, you know, irritation that they feel there. And this spills over to sexual pain. I mean, it's so dry, people try and have sexual have sex and are very unsuccessful in being successful and enjoying sex. And a lot of people really don't even realize, I'm very surprised, but a lot of people don't even realize that sexual pain at this time is related to menopause. And it sure is. And it's really the easiest thing I know to treat. The easiest thing I treat is this vaginal dryness. And so, but this really, and so many people come in and are so upset because they had such a wonderful life of intimacy with their partners for so long, and now it just, they run. They think of ways to get away from their partner who they know is going to ask, that they're going to ask for it. And it's so frustrating for people. And of course, it causes a low sex drive. People just are over it. and get over it and just, and it, this can be a real difficult point in a relationship. And I've seen I've had a lot of people come in and just say, you know, my relationship is on the rocks here because, you know, I'm not interested. So again, easy fix. It really is. And I'm not trying to minimize it, but I'm trying to say there are so many things that we can help people with, but people don't know. And again, there's so many ideas out there and so much poor information. Weight gain is another thing that I think is very frustrating for people, because weight gain, we do see weight gain with the menopause, and on average, women will gain 8 pounds. And what's really frustrating, and people throw stones at me when I say this, but the weight many times goes to the middle, just much like men, but the weight goes to the middle, which is very frustrating for people, that the where the fat is on your body shifts. And so, but it doesn't mean you can't lose weight, and it doesn't mean that at all. And so it's one of those times that you really have to reevaluate what you're doing, what you're eating. And it takes a little bit more work, but it's very, very possible. And we see a lot of people just stop and kind of give in to the weight gain. And that leads to a lot of chronic problems, the diabetes, the high blood pressure, all those things. And this is a time where you really want to stop and talk to somebody who really understands this and get a game plan. Because again, it's very, very doable. Life is not over. And so, and I wanted to bring up urinary tract infections because, you know, this goes along with the vaginal dryness. There is actually a movement in people that are interested in menopause. There's actually a movement going on where elderly women and who have gone to like nursing homes, oftentimes, and if you're a medical student, you see this a million times, that they come into the hospital and they have a serious infection because of the urinary tract. And one of the main reasons why we all believe that this happens to women is because of vaginal dryness. It affects the bladder, and there's a much increased risk of infections, because all the things in your body that's there to protect you against infection goes away. And so, again, an easy fix. What's the fix? Vaginal estrogen. And so it's very safe. And so that's another thing. And then skin changes are also something that women really talk about and just really are so frustrated with, because they are... their skin changes. And there's a lot on that I'm not going to go into, because we're going to have in another episode of this podcast, this webinar, we're going to have an esthetician, a beauty specialist, talk to you about skin. And I think that will be very, very helpful to you all. Let me go to, I lost my screen here. My apologies. But I'm going to go now to some treatments of what we want to share with people. Now, remember, treatments, we really individualize. And so what we need to do is we need to, there we are. We need to really help people with treatments according to what group of symptoms they have. So we individualize depending upon what symptoms you do and don't have. Most of these treatments have to do with the hot flashes. So let me go through these and I'm going to emphasize a couple of them. First of all, lifestyle. There's a lot about lifestyle that is written about dressing in layers, about, we talk about triggers. Like, for instance, you know, drinking a hot cup of coffee at this time can trigger hot flashes. Alcohol can trigger hot flashes. There's a lot of triggers. Exercise will actually help hot flashes. So it's a lot about lifestyle. And then hormonal medications, I'm going to save to last because I have a soapbox. I have a lot to say about that, that I want to just make sure it's clear, that the message is clear. Non-hormonal medications. This is so important because some people just will not use hormones or can't because of a medical condition. And right now we have a group of non-hormonal medications that work to some degree. And we have the hope of one coming out possibly next year. It's under study this year. And hopefully if the FDA approves it by next year, it will be a fabulous new weapon, if you will, against hot flashes. But right now, most of the non-hormonal prescription medications are actually antidepressants. And they don't work because we think you're depressed. In fact, we use them in really low doses. We don't want the antidepressant action of these medications. In really low doses, they do have an anti-flushing effect because they work in the brain where the temperature sense the temperature center is, and they work about 40% of the time. And then there are other medications in that group, but I just wanted to let you know about those. The compounding pharmacy is another place where there's a lot of activity. And I'm very concerned about compounding. It's incredibly popular. It was popularized back in 2002 when there was a big study that was very damning about estrogen. And people ran to compounding pharmacies, but there's a lot of problems with that. There's not very much good research on that. There's some dangers and some things that have come out about compounding pharmacies that are very concerning to a lot of us. And so I'm just not a big compounding pharmacy person. Herbal remedies, I really encourage people who have found something to use them, unless when you go online, a lot of the remedies that I've seen, they say that, you know, you look for what's inside, and they say a proprietary combination of things. And if you're not willing to tell me what's in your product, I'm not willing to use it. So, but a lot of remedies that are out, especially like the phytoestrogen is a group of herbals. Supplements that can act like the hormone estrogen. And there are some people that are very successful using these and a lot of people that are not. And so again, it just, sometimes it takes a discussion and then just trial to see if that works for you. They take several months to work, and so you've got to be patient with it. The one herbal medicine that I use quite often is, you can only get on the internet. It's called Relizen, R-E-L-I-Z-E-N, Relizen. It's a bee pollen. It's made in the Scandinavian countries, and it actually has the most research I've seen on any of the herbal remedies, and I love it. I use it often. It's about $35 a month, and you deal with the company directly. I don't have anything to do with it. Then there's devices out there, and those are, you know, you can do watches, there's sprays, there's all sorts of devices that can help with hot flashes. Be careful. They're all over the internet, and they're pricey. And so, and once you buy them, you buy them. And if it doesn't work, you're out the money. And then there's also psychological programs, and these work and they help you mentally do things when you get these hot flashes that there are a fair amount of success with these also. So there's a lot of approaches, but I want to go back to the hormonal medications because I want to just take a minute because there's been so many damning things come out about hormones, specifically estrogen. And this happened because back in 2002, there was a large study that came out that was pretty negative on hormones. And within five years, we really came to understand how to use hormones and who we could suggest them to and who not to give them to. And we really figured out a way to give them to people that was really pretty safe. But the world never caught up with any of that ongoing research. And there's wonderful guidelines out now that have been rewritten as we learn more about how to very specifically and very safely use hormones. And there's a lot of people who qualify to use hormones who won't because they're afraid because they've been told very, very negative things. And I think I have a lot of people who started off not wanting them, but you know, found a lot of these things didn't work and finally used estrogen and was very happy because estrogen by far and away is the most the thing that works the best. And so I think you want to again have a discussion with somebody who really understands the principles of using estrogen and how to do it safely for you with your medical history and where you're at in life. And you know, you can't say this in a short talk like this because it's so individualized, but we know so much about that. And I just feel bad that a lot of people aren't getting the true relief that they could have because of a fear that somebody's put in their brain. And so I think hormones is a tremendous way to go, and they're very safe. You can use them both orally and through the skin. If you're concerned about like blood clots, if you take it through the skin, that decreases the risk of blood clots. A lot of people are, I think the greatest fear is the breast cancer thing. If you've had a hysterectomy, then I would only give estrogen to a person who's had a hysterectomy. And actually in the study that scared everybody, the people who had a hysterectomy and just used estrogen alone and not with progesterone actually had a decrease in breast cancers of 20%. So, you know, there's so much that's known about this, how to use this very safely. And if you're getting a hysterectomy or need one, you want to have that discussion as to whether you want to keep your ovaries or not, what you're going to do. Because you're going to get a lot of symptoms if you just have everything taken out and don't do anything about it. So Courtney, that's kind of what I wanted to just talk about. Now, the one other thing that I wanted to say, here's some contact information for me if you want to have some of these discussions. But I would really encourage people go to menopause.org. That's the website to the North American Menopause Society. That's who I took the certification through. I think they're the organization that really puts out the most about this subject. And there's a tab on the top of everything that says for women. And if you go on that tab and click on that tab, there's something called the Menopause Guidebook. And it's really written for a non-medical person that has so much of this information. So please go there. So thanks, Courtney.
Yeah, thank you so much for your presentation. And we're gonna go ahead and take questions. And the first question we have was, what was the one supplement that can be ordered online? And I believe it was Relizin.
Yes, I'll spell it again. It's, there you go.
Okay, perfect.
Okay, you got it, Courtney. That's cool. It's Relizen. And you just go to, you know, Relizen.com and the company will come up. The company's name is Bonafide. So
We're going to go ahead and open up for more questions, but we have some that were sent in. One of the questions is, how long will I have hot flashes and experience this?
That's a great question. Thank you for asking that. You know, some people go months. Some people go years, but sorry to say that the kind of an average time is 7 years, and it can go as long as 10. So it's no joke. I mean, if you're getting hit hard, you want to get some help to get through that transition. So.
Another question that we had sent in is, I started menopause and I'm finding it harder to lose weight. What should I do?
Great question again. And it is a challenge because a lot of, you know, how much energy your body uses to live in a day can change. And again, I think you need to, at this time, really talk to, again, somebody who's very knowledgeable in a program. You know, I think people come in and say, well, I'm so frustrated. I've been watching what I eat. And you know, if you watch what you eat, that's not really a program. You want a program, and you want to remember two very important principles: that weight loss happens at the dinner table, but keeping the weight off happens at the gym. And if you remember those two things and talk to somebody about what to do at the dinner table in light of your age and what's going on, I think you'll find great success.
Another question we have, are there specialists for menopause?
Yes. If you go to menopause.org, go on, you know, for women, again, there is find a menopause, what do we call it? A menopause practitioner is what they call it. Find a menopause practitioner. And all of us who've gone through this training are listed on that site. And I'm actually in the midst of training another person in Defiance to do this. And so there's going to be more people, but that's how you find the list of menopause practitioners.
Right. It looks like we don't have any more questions.
Okay.
Do we have a topic for next month?
Yeah. You know, we have a lot of topics, and so we're thinking about certainly talking about this esthetician or this beauty specialist, especially for midlife. We want to get them in the mix, and also, I think, one thing that doctors, we always talk about in the Defiance area is the need for more education on contraception. And I think with everything that's going on in the world now, it's a real appropriate discussion to have concerning contraception and, you know, just being able to control when you want a baby, because I find that being in Defiance, that most of the people coming in pregnant did not plan to be pregnant. It was not that they're upset that they're pregnant, but most of them are oopses. And we want to show people, you know, how to plan. So it's going to be one of those topics.
All right. All right. Thank you for everybody joining us today. Look
Thank
for
you.
Our next webinar at the end of September. Thank you.
Have a great day.